Thank you for tuning in to Upon the Rock broadcast. I'm your host, Pastor Lawrence Shakir. I believe the Word of God will build a godly foundation in the lives of people. There is more available information on our website. You can log on to shakirministries.org. Now, let's go on to today's message.
A dime of a dollar. A dime of a dollar. How many of y'all want to guess what that's talking about? Not you all. You know, you saw my sermon preparation. They know what's going on. Last week I talked to you all about what? Tithing. Oh my goodness, I came on a tithing Sunday. Yes, you did. I'm sorry. We got you now. Lock the doors. What I attempt to do on this teaching, now y'all know I'm not a guy who always talks about stuff like this every week, but I think we do need to talk about it because, number one, like I told you all last week about how it's been abused. But I also think we just need the right kind of perspective. I don't think you need to talk about tithing every week or every other month, but I do think you ought to have something that's so strong that people can always go back and refer to it. That's one of the reasons why I'm recording it. That's one of the reasons why I'm talking about it now. And probably I won't have to talk about this until another year or so. But my point is, my objective is to lay a good godly foundation when it comes to tithing. Because there's a lot of stuff out there on people. Well, you ain't got to tithe. That's an Old Testament thing. We're going to deal with all of that. We're going to deal with should you tithe, why you tithe, and so forth. I personally, if you ask me, I've been tithing ever since I had a job. And it's not something that God has put a chokehold on me and put a gun to my head. I just learned the spiritual part of it, of tithing, and I recognize how God honors that. Now, we're not under the law. We're under grace. We're going to go through all of that. But it's the reason why God even placed it in the Bible in the first place. Not to scare people away, because this is a subject people like put that little raggedy Baptist finger up and they start making their way to the door. This is one of those teachings that cause people like, oh man. But you know what? It's the reason why God wants a dime out of every dollar. But he doesn't need the money because he has money in heaven. Well, he has gold in heaven, and he doesn't really need, the currency in heaven is not material stuff that we have. The currency in heaven is actually more faith. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. But in the currency of our world and our culture, it's you know, the money. Back then it was sheeps. Back then it was other things. But whatever was valuable at that time, God says, I want that. Now, is God being selfish when he asks, I want that? I don't think he's being selfish. Why would he say, and I'm going to open the floor on this one, why would God say, give me that? If it means something to you, I want that. Why would he say that? Okay. Go ahead. It's okay.
I don't know. Come back to me.
She said, come back to her. Okay. Well, exactly. Why would God tell Abraham, give me your son, your only son? Did he need him?
No.
No. But why would God say that?
I mean, he sacrificed his son for
him. Yeah. In other words, before, see, God already has in his mind what he's going to do, but before God does something, where time has to catch up with it, he'll always come back to where you're at and say, give me this. And let me see how you do that. If you can do this, it'll cause me to do this. So it's not about the dime so much. It's about your relationship with the money. I think that's what he's after. And on the back of your money, what does it say? In God we trust. But we write that down, but does people actually really believe that? Or is that just something that's just written on the money? Because some people say, oh, in money we trust. But they want to put in God we trust because that sounds more politically correct. So God wants us to really trust him with this. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you through the stages of this, and we're going to dissect this. I'm going to open the floor and everything. But go ahead, sir, if you don't mind. The first tithe. So I got to show you all the first thing of why it was in the Bible. Then I'm going to show you when it came to the law. Then I'm going to show you on how believers are supposed to do it today. So the first tithe was through Abraham. If you all know the story, Abraham went to war with this king. He only had 318 people in his camp. He didn't have a whole army like these other kings. He just had 318 servants. They were kind of people that kind of like watched his house and watched his goats and that kind of thing. There wasn't fighting men like you were determined. So the reason why Abraham went to war is because his nephew Lot was kidnapped by this kingdom, right? So he took what he had and he went to war and ended up winning anyway. with only 318 guys against, you know, another nation, another king. He came back, and this is what we pick up in Genesis chapter 14, verse 18. It says, then Melchizedek, everybody say Melchizedek. I know that's a kind of a harder name, but Melchizedek, king of Salem. Salem is short for Jerusalem or city of peace. That's what Salem means. It means peace. So here was Melchizedek, king of peace. Okay. What is Jesus called? Prince of peace. So we're going to do a little bit more research on this Melchizedek guy, because Melchizedek just kind of showed up out of nowhere. Melchizedek, king of peace, king of Salem, brought out bread and wine. When you think of bread and wine, what do you think of? Communion, the body and the blood. So I want you all, and we're going to talk about the Trinity in bronze, but I want you all to see the characteristics of this one guy first. Okay? He was the priest of the Most High God. Now notice, before this time, there was no such thing as priest. Because before there was a priest, well, the first priest was actually come from Levi, the Levitical priesthood. Well, Levi wasn't born yet because Abraham was several generations before him. So when this guy says he was the priest of the Most High God, there was no such thing as a priest of the Most High God. Where do you come from? I just want to kind of show you this a little bit. Then he said, blessed be Abraham by God Most High, creator of heaven and earth, verse 20, and blessed be God Most High, which is another word of saying El Elyon, the Most High God. We're going to get into the names of God too. And blessed be the Most High God who delivered your enemies out of your hands. Then Abraham gave him tithes of everything. I want us to not just read over that. This guy showed up who was a priest of the Most High God. He came out of nowhere, basically. First priest, we don't even know, and we're going to go into a little more details on him. But then Abraham just decided, I'm going to give you tithe. No, notice, nobody told Abraham to do anything. He could have just said, oh, thank you for that blessing, and kept on going on his merry way. But he decided to give tithes of all. There's a reason why God called Abraham a friend. Because a friend, a true friend, a true person who got your heart, they kind of think like you. They kind of move like you. They're not somebody off the wall. You think in this direction. You ever had a good friend where you were about to say something and your friend said the thing before you said it? You're like, man, I was just thinking that. Well, that's kind of how Abraham was. When God called him friend, he called him friend because you think like me, Abraham. And he says that, you know, he blessed him, and then Abraham just automatically, without anybody telling him to do it, without any kind of push-up or prop-ups or anything, without any kind of law, he just decided, whatever I just taken from this kingdom, I'm going to give God a tenth out of that, or I'm going to give it to this priest. So it's almost like the priest was like, why'd you do that? But he knows why he did it, because he's, you know, he's connected to him like that. But I want you all to see the first tithe. This is how, whenever you see something in the Bible the first time, it always sets the tone. It's the foundation of how you should do things. Anytime you see it first in the Bible, and this is the first time, okay? So go to my next point real quick. Abraham gave tithes. He did not pay tithes. In other words, a payment is something, is somebody gives you something, and that's a bill. You got to give it back to them. That's a payment, right? But this time it said Abraham gave tithes. What is a gift? Something that you just gave. If it's Christmas time, if it's birthdays, nobody didn't make you buy that gift for that friend or that family member. You just gave it out of the goodness of your heart. You hear what I'm saying? So when Abraham gave tithes, he didn't pay tithes. Oh, I'm going to pay my tithes. I know people say that out of a cultural thing, but the proper way of actually giving tithes is giving tithes, not paying tithes, because it's not a debt. It's not something that God says, you owe me this. But for so long, the churches will say that. If you don't give, you cursed. What a curse. And on top of a curse. But that should not ever be your motive of giving, because you're going to be cursed with a curse on top of a curse. Now, but what did you do with that scripture? We're going to get with that too. What's the next point, sir? Why did he give tithes? Did God command him to do so? Now, did God tell him to do this? No. So he just gave it because out of his heart, he wanted to show some type of reverence, some type of honor. And then it just moved on his heart to do this. Next point. So what was Abraham's motive behind him giving tithe? He just wanted to be thankful. He just wanted to appreciate God. You've done this for me. But notice, we see him as God. Well, I don't want to get ahead of myself. But Abraham saw Melchizedek as somebody that represents God. That's what happened here. Now let's go and dissect who Melchizedek is. Next point, please. There are two types of priests. There's a Melchizedek, which is the high priest of Salem, Most High God. And then there's the Levitical priest, Aaron, which is actually the first priest. I think it's going out, but you all see Aaron right there with the little shiny suit on. Forgive me, I'm sorry. But he got the nice stuff on, and he looks all nice and flashy. And that was something that God had ordained. So Aaron's on one side, and you got Melchizedek, this mystery priest, on another side. The point that I'm giving you all two of them is because if you give tithes, you're going to give in two different ways. You're going to give to like Melchizedek kind of way, or you're going to give like to the Levitical priest, Aaron, okay? Now, I got to give you all this kind of balance because I want you all to recognize that this church, the way we give tithes, and then let me just back up a little bit. Like I said, I've been a tither ever since I had a job. I still give tithes. This church gives tithes to my spiritual dad's church and so forth. I give tithes. I've been giving tithes all of this time, and I believe that the reason why I live in a kind of blessing flow is because of the tithe. Not because I'm afraid I'm going to get cursed. It's not that. It's because I just recognize God in my life, and that dime or that dollar does not mean anything to me. God doesn't mind you living off the rest. All he wants is the dime, and he looks at how you get the dime. Are you going to get the dime first, or are you going to get it last? God looks at that. So it's either Melchizedek, everybody say Melchizedek, or Aaron. So it's going to be one of the two. Go to my next point. I'm going to dissect Melchizedek. If you look in Hebrews chapter 7, verse 1, it gives you a whole chapter on this Melchizedek guy. And forgive me if I go on too fast on this. It's so much in here that I'm trying to take out certain points so you all can gain understanding. This Melchizedek, king of the city of Salem or city of peace, is also a priest of the Most High God. When Abraham was returning home after winning a great battle against the kings, Melchizedek met him and blessed him. Verse 2. Abraham took a tenth of all he had captured in the battle and gave it to Melchizedek. The name of Melchizedek means king of justice or king of peace. The king of Salem means king of peace. Watch this, verse 3. I want you all to zone in on this part. Verse 3. There is no record of his father or his mother or any ancestor. In other words, if you look at Melchizedek, he was not born by a human. He doesn't have a father and he doesn't have a mother. Okay? And he has no ancestors, or he has nobody connected to him, no offspring, no nothing. How in the world did this guy just come up in the world without a father and a mother? Close. It's called a theophany. A theophany is some kind of way that God showed up on the planet before he was known as Jesus Christ. A theophany was the fire fire by night and a cloud by day. When they said they were following God, that was God, the burning bush, a theophany. It was God that was showing, because God the Father, and we're going to get into the Trinity, God the Father sits in heaven. He doesn't leave. God the Son is the tangible part of God. There's still God, but it's the part of God that you can see and touch, because the Bible says you cannot see God and live. Talking about God the Father. But God the Son, you can see that part of God, but he would show up before he was known as Jesus as these little kind of blues clues first. Maybe a burning bush, maybe a cloud in the sky, maybe this mystery guy. He would show up these kinds of ways, and then the word kept going, kept going, kept going, kept going. And then the Bible said the word became flesh and dwelt among men. But before it became flesh, he would show up in these different times of history to get people to be on the right kind of track. If God would have just let his word be there and say, okay, you all handle that, I think y'all gonna get there. No, he had to kind of come in every now and then and say, you need to do this. And he'll step back, come back later on with Moses. Okay, I'm the guy who did this. He'll step back, come back with Elijah or somebody. And he'll show up these different kinds of ways so that we can all say, wait a minute, that was God. See, in the scripture, it said that they were following God through the desert. And you're like, what do you mean following God? Well, there was a theophany part of God. Before he was known as Jesus, that we know as Jesus, he showed up these kinds of ways. So when it says he was without father, without mother, a lot of people think, yeah, that's an angel. But it also said that he was a priest of the Most High God. An angel, and now I'm going to teach on angels in bronze too. See, y'all getting ready for this stuff. That's all that is. But all of this, All of these teachings kind of line up for this one. It's FBI is the ultimate series of sermons that I have. 48 teachings for this whole year. Anyway, then Abraham took a tenth of all he captured. I'm going to go to verse 3. There is no record of his father or mother or any ancestors. No beginning and no end to his life. Melchizedek. He remains a priest forever. Now, who in the world can remain a priest forever? It's not an angel, and it's not none of us a human. Got to be talking about only one person that can do that. A priest forever? You mean to tell me this guy, because let's just say if he's not Jesus, then how in the world you have two priests that will last forever then? Got to be talking about one person. But before he was known as what we know as Jesus Christ, he showed up as stuff like this. He remains a priest forever, resembling, watch this, the Son of God. More Blues Clues. More clues to let you know God is just doing a few things. He's connecting the dots so that by the time he gets to a certain time in history, everybody can trace back and say, okay, that was God right there. That was God right here. And I didn't know that, but now that I think about it, that was God. That's how God reveals himself. Okay, go to the next point, please. Before Abraham, men only offered sacrificing offerings to God. Before Abraham, okay? Next point. Or is this freezing? They presented these offerings out of respect for God. The motive behind their giving was out of respect. It wasn't any kind of law. Nobody didn't have to make them do anything. They just did it because they honored God. We were talking about the sacrifice of praise. You just do it not because somebody gets up with a microphone and says, lift your hands. Then you say something. No. You get up there and you just give him the sacrifice of praise out of the fruit of your lips, right? But that's what we have to do. We got to make sure that everything we do, it comes out of our heart. It comes out of the right kind of foundation. Otherwise, you're just being religious and there's no power in that. Next point. Oh, you got it. Thank you. Abraham's motive for tithing was out of love, not just respect. He respected God, but he also loved God, and he was the friend of God. Okay? I'm walking around. Are you all comfortable with the air? Okay. Good. Because I know I can get hot here. Maybe I'm just on fire because of this teaching. I don't know. Next point, please. That's it. Verse 4. Consider how great this Melchizedek was. Even Abraham, the great patriarch of Israel, recognized this by giving him a tenth of what he had taken from battle. So in other words, Abraham was probably one of the shot callers of the Bible. But even he knew that this guy, whoever this guy is, he's greater than me. Otherwise, why would this guy even bless me? Because the Bible says that Melchizedek blessed him, right? Nobody who was inferior to you can bless you. They have to be somebody big or somebody who's carrying some kind of weight. So Melchizedek was that. And Abraham recognized that because he was sensitive to God. All right. Even Abraham, great patriarch of Israel, recognized that by giving him a tenth what he had. Verse 5. Now, the law of Moses required that a priest who are descendants of Levi must collect a tithe from the rest of the people of Israel. So who are descendants of Abraham. So this is before before Levi was even born. Abraham had this kind of thing with this Melchizedek guy. Verse 6. But Melchizedek, who was not a descendant of Levi, he didn't come from Abraham's loins. He was just some other guy. But Melchizedek, who was not a descendant of Levi, collected a tenth from Abraham, and Melchizedek placed a blessing upon Abraham. So he gave him the tenth, and then Melchizedek gave him the blessing. He gave the tenth. He didn't pay the tenth, but he gave the tenth, and then there was a blessing on him. The one who had already received the promise from God. Okay, so let's go to the next point. I want to keep going because there's a lot on here. And without question, the person who has the power to give a blessing is greater than the one who was blessed. I just said that. The priests who collect tithes are men who die. So Melchizedek is greater than they are. So he's not just a regular priest or a regular high priest. He's greater than the high priest of that of what we know about. Okay, y'all get anything so far out of this? So Melchizedek is greater than they because we are told that he lives on. Melchizedek lives on. I never seen Melchizedek. Actually, you have. You just don't know that. It's Jesus. We know him as Jesus. But back then, since the book of Hebrews, you have to communicate this to a more of a Jewish kind of people who just didn't accept that Jesus was the Lord and Savior. They had to connect these dots because they did respect Abraham and Moses and all these other people in the Bible. In addition, we might even say that these Levites who were the ones who collect the tithes paid tithes to Melchizedek and when their ancestor Abraham paid tithes to him. Now that one says pays, but it's actually referring to the same kind of way that I'm saying here, but it's actually translated that they gave tithes at the same time. In other words, before my children were born, when I said I was giving tithes when I was a kid, when I first got a job, when I gave tithes, they gave tithes. So in other words, tithing is in our ancestry kind of thing, right? So that's what he's talking about when it comes to Levites. Verse 10, for although Levi wasn't born yet, the seed from which he came was in Abraham's body when Melchizedek collected the tithe from him. So he's basically saying that there is a kind of generational blessing that happens when you begin to honor God with the tithe. Let's just tell it what it is. Now, is this a thing that preachers made up to get your money? I mean, that's what people say. You ain't got to give tithes. Let that church starve. Okay. You can let it starve, but why would God even place something like this in the Bible if he didn't want us to at least consider it? Think about it. If God didn't want us to even talk about this, it wouldn't even made it to the Bible. Next point. So if the priesthood of Levi on which the law was based, could have achieved perfection God intended, why did God need to establish a different priesthood? In other words, this, if God spent all this time, if you read the book of Leviticus, you see all those laws and they kind of like wear your mind out like, man, I'm willing to get past this Leviticus. If God took all that time to make something that was perfect and it ended up having flaws, then why did God erase that and start all over and do something else? Because in the Levitical part, he says, yes, I want you to pay these tithes and give it to the high priest and do all this and so forth. But then it got to the point where God says, let's just do away with that and let's just do something else, something new. That's what he's talking about right here. If it could achieve perfection as God intended, then why did God need to establish a different type of priesthood with the priests in an order of Melchizedek? Everybody say the order of Melchizedek. So it's an order of Melchizedek, or in other words, the kind of function of Melchizedek, all right? Instead of the order of Levi and Aaron. How come God put Melchizedek more on a pedestal than Levi and Aaron when he spent so much time trying to develop this Levitical priesthood? We're going to get there. All right, verse 12, and if the priesthood is changed, the law must also be changed to permit it. For these priests that we are talking about belongs to a different tribe. Those members have never served at an altar as priests. Verse 14. What I mean is our Lord came from a tribe of Judah. In other words, he didn't come from Levi. He came from Judah, which is a different type of tribe, talking about Jesus. And Moses never mentioned priests coming from that tribe. So the Levitical priesthood, excuse me, I'm trying to just give you all this theology and this doctrine wrapped up into a way that you all, you know, can swallow it. But the point is that he had the Levi thing going real good, but he wanted to establish another one, and he started out with Judah, which is where Jesus came from, the tribe of Judah, the line of Judah, and so forth. Let's go to the next point. So here's the last part right here. Verse 15. This change has been made very clear since a different priest who is like Melchizedek has appeared. Verse 16. Jesus became a priest not by meeting a physical requirement, like how the Levites had to do, requirement of belonging to the tribe of Levi, but the power of life that cannot be destroyed. Verse 17, and the psalmist pointed this out when he prophesied. In other words, all these words kept lining up. You are a priest forever, talking about Jesus, in the order of Melchizedek. In other words, how Jesus functions now, he doesn't function like a high priest like the Levite high priest. He functions as a high priest like Melchizedek. So when you give your tithes, if you give it under a law like how the Levites thing is, you're just doing it because you're trying to follow the law. Sometimes you do things because you need to develop a good habit, but then it gets to the point where you need to just do it because you are mature and you love God and you just have a certain thing. Let me ask you a question. How many of y'all like to brush your teeth? Raise your hand. All right, everybody in here. Thank God. How many of y'all like to, you know, put on clean clothes? Deodorant. Wash your face. Cut your hair or do your hair. How many of y'all like to do that? So, but when you were a kid, I don't know about you, but didn't your mama used to tell you, did you brush your teeth today? Yeah. Didn't they do that? Are those clean clothes? Change some clothes, you know. When you was a kid, that's what happens. It's the boys. Oh, okay, because I got boys. That's probably why. Well, I was a boy too. But anyway, my mom had to tell me, did you brush your teeth today, boy? No, get upstairs and brush your teeth. My point is, when you're a kid, people got to tell you what to do. They got to tell you, put some deodorant on. Wash your face. You got cross all on your eyes. Wash your face. You know, when you're a kid. But when you're an adult, how many of y'all as adults, your mom call you, girl, did you brush your teeth today? Anybody going to do that, right? Because you know better. You get to a point where it just kind of clicks. You do it, not because somebody, I mean, because it's not a law that you got to brush your teeth. Nobody, it should be. But nobody's doing 25 to life because they didn't brush their teeth. Right? But if you're smart, you would brush your teeth. I'm just using that because that's what we had. But basically, you do certain things because it's the right thing to do. When it comes to the Christianity or the Christian walk, God showed us through Israel first. Abraham set the foundation by doing it in love. But everybody who came after Abraham were not like Abraham. They had to be told what to do because they didn't have that kind of heart sensitive for him. So they had to have a law. You need to do this. But then it got to the point they kept doing it and they were pretty good at it and they start to mature. And it got to the point like when you mature, nobody will have to tell you anything now. It ought to just hit your heart now. So then Jesus shows up in the order of Melchizedek and all of this law was there. Yeah, it's there. But it's almost like the way you view the law is different. You can do it and think because you're supposed to do this, or you can do it because that's what you know you need to do. You get what I'm saying? That's where God is trying to take the body of Christ, is that you don't just do this. I mean, think about it. We talk about devotions and read the Bible. But if you don't read your Bible for a month, you're not going to go to hell. You know what I'm saying? Now, I'm not saying don't read your Bible. I'm just saying if you're smart and you want to be mature, you ought to open this Bible and read it. But God is not going to curse you because you didn't read your Bible today. That's not part of the any kind of curse. So he gave us the word, but it's still up to us to go forward and do it. God will give you the word of what you should do, but then it's up to you if you're going to do it or not. Let's go to my next point. So far, y'all getting anything? All right. So what I'm going to show you now is some kind of order when it comes to the Levitical priesthood. Now, I want y'all to stay with me because I know this is kind of a heavy subject, but just bear with me because we're going to get through this. When it comes to the Levitical priesthood, he told them a certain types of laws, and I'm going to just highlight just one of them because you can go to any church and everybody's all day talking about you need to give, you need to do this, you hear that enough. But let's talk about what God's perspective is when it comes to, because we talked about generosity and giving last time, but this time we're going to focus more on the tithe only because there are certain things that's attached to the tithe rather than just the regular giving. So every third year you must offer a special tithe of your crops. Now, everybody say special. In other words, there are certain times of the year. Now, this is talking about the law, but there are certain times of the year where God will tell you, I want you to do something special. Y'all get that? Like, you can go beyond. You know what you do all the time. But then there's some certain times when God says, I want you to do this. And it makes you kind of like cringe a little bit. I don't know about you all, but that's what happened with me. And I'm not trying to, again, brag on myself. But I remember the first time God told me to give $1,000 to a ministry. And I was saving up this money, putting some aside because I did the pilot church in Arizona and I just got a little over $1,000. And then God spoke to me on a special thing and says, I need you to give that $1,000 away to this ministry who's trying to stop girls from being trafficked and stop girls from doing this. And I was like, ooh, no, but your mind will try to rationalize it. No, don't you do that, because if you do that, then you're not going to be able to do this. Blah, 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 blah. And you start thinking, if you think through it too much, you're not going to obey God. Sometimes God wants you to see, are you going to move right when I say this? So I had a decision to make. God wasn't going to curse me if I didn't do it, but he had something lined up. So he wouldn't tell me what that thing is behind his back. So he just says, I want you to do this. And I had to hurry up and do what God called me to do. When that happens, then things start going to pass and, you know, the church start going forward and that sort of thing. Then I got to Arizona. Then I got to Georgia. And then, you know, I was in the process of starting this church in Sandy Springs. Saved up some money again. And what happened? God says, I want you to give $1,000 again. But this time, I didn't have a, you know, thing, because the first time it's kind of scary. The second time, God just wanted to see, can you still trust me with this? And I'm not trying to give you all numbers. I'm just trying to let you know that some things are just special that God wants to see, can he trust you with? Now, he don't tell me to do that all the time, but there are some occasions where God will tell you to do something, and you know it's God, because you know the devil ain't going to talk like that, and you know it's not you, so it got to be God. So he will tell them, like, this special kind of thing, I need you to do this special thing, and he kind of waits and see if you're going to do it. Now, again, You're not going to be, you know, in danger of hellfire if you don't. But you will stop up the purpose that God has for your life if you don't do it. Sometimes God wants you to just do it because he knows that you're on the track of this greatness, but this one thing is standing in your way. If you can jump over this one thing, then I can trust you with this next level. So that's why it's like sometimes a special kind of thing. In this year, special tithes you must give, your tithes to the Levites, foreigners, and orphans. In other words, if they support this kind of thing that God's called them to do, it will help foreigners, it'll help orphans, it'll help widows, it'll help the community. That's what he was talking about. Verse 13, you must declare this in the presence of your God. I have taken a sacred gift. In other words, what he said right there is you need to kind of speak over your, and I know this may sound a little bit too much, but you need to kind of speak over your finances. Oftentimes, I normally do, like, whenever I give, I kind of like say something between me and God. Lord, this gift I'm giving to you. Yeah, and I make a decree. I kind of like say something over it before I put it in there. Sometimes I just put it in there, but every now and then I just kind of just say something over this. And that's where this scripture came from. Speak over this sacred gift. Speak over it and say, I've taken a sacred gift from my house and have given it to the Levites, the foreigners. In other words, I am not in violation of any of your commands. In other words, Lord, I'm doing this because I honor you, I honor your word, and I trust you with this. So every now and then before you give, you kind of need to say something. And maybe we need to do that when it comes to offering, have some kind of offering confession from now on. But my point is, speak over this because God is actually looking at that when you connect your gift to his kingdom. Okay? Y'all okay so far? Mm-hmm. All right. Next point, please. All right. So you're going to have this kind of situation in your mind. You're going to have in the middle, you have this cash. And cash is king, right? He got a little crown on. So he's jumping up. And so you know what that cash want to go to because that cash will start speaking to you. You got bills to pay. Mm-hmm. And then you're like, Lord, I got bills. And then sometimes it says, I know you got bills. But either you're going to give it to me or you're going to give it to bills. You can put it in your 401k. You can put all that money in there. But you probably won't even know where it's. Have you ever saved up or done something and you don't even know where the money went, even though you kind of place it in the bank and the savings account and you're like, oh Lord, I just got paid. Where my money at? You got a bag full of holes in it, it seems like. God is saying that basically you can trust the world because the world already has a quote unquote curse on it from when it comes, if you date all the way back to Adam, because the world that we know now it's pretty out there, but it actually looked a lot prettier before the fall of man came. So there's one type of quote unquote curse, but then there's another kind of curse when you're just outside the will of God. So when he says right here, I want you to trust me with this, you have a decision to make. Either cash is going to go toward things of God or it's going to go toward the things of the world. Now, the world will always try to get your money, try to get your tithe, try to get your everything. But notice what it says in verse 14. I have not eaten any of it while in mourning. I'm going through this thing and the temptation is for me to eat my tithe, but I'm not going to eat it. I'm going to either trust God with it or I'm going to trust the world with it. Now, if you trust the world with it, the Bible says you sow to the flesh, you're going to reap corruption. So you can trust the world with it all day long. But what happens when recession hits then? Like, oh, Lord, I should have trusted God. Yeah, you probably should have trusted God because at least God will have some type of thing that will rebuke the devourer for your sake on it. So he says, I have not yet eaten the tithe while in mourning, when I had a bad time, when I couldn't have enough money and I didn't have enough money to pay these bills. I could have spent it on that, but I decided to still trust you with it. See, that's what separates some of these people that really want to be on God's side. When the rubber meets the road and you know that you could be doing this with that, but you still going to trust God anyway. God, that gets God's attention. Y'all get anything so far? All right. So I have not yet eaten it. I have not handled it. I have not handled it while I was in ceremony unclean, and I have not yet offered it to the dead. I have obeyed the Lord my God, and I have done everything you have commanded me. Now look down from your holy dwelling place in heaven and bless your people, Israel, and the land you swore to your ancestors to give us, a land flowing with milk and honey. Because I'm trusting you with this, awaken the promises that you already have stored up for me. Because I'm trusting you with this, I believe I qualify according to the word for these promises to come to pass. I have this dream, Lord, And yes, I could have spent this money for that dream, but I'm going to trust you with it. So you have to do your part of making this dream come to pass, because I can't do it. You can try the world's way and try to do everything right, have A1 credit. You can work overtime and get promotions and do all of that, and you still will not be overcoming anything, because the world system is designed to keep you in bondage. So God says that basically you got to tap into another type of system, which is like the kingdom of heaven system. I know it almost sounds like a prosperity gospel, but it's not. It's actually Bible. But you all will have to kind of determine if you're going to do this or not, because at the end of the day, this cash is going to be jumping up and down. Where am I going to go? Where am I going to go? And if cash is king in your life and you want to do stuff toward the world, then it probably won't last. You'll be just like this guy shaking the little piggy bank. You saved up everything you can, but it won't come to pass to anything. You got to have a God portion of your Christian walk that no matter what happens, this is going towards God. You got to have that. Next point. So, and I'm just going to blow through these a little bit, and we're almost done. Y'all are doing good. They were commanded. Everybody say commanded. They were commanded to take care of the house of God, the priests, and the orphans. In other words, this was the law. You're going to take care of the Levites, because the Levites at this tribe, they didn't work. Their job was the kingdom or the house of God. So they didn't go out there and plow. They didn't go out there and have sheep. They were taking care of all the house of God, and the other tribes kind of just helped them stay afloat, basically. So it was a law for them to take care of the priests, because if the house of God was in ruin, then the whole community was in ruin. So he says, you're going to take care of these priests. You're going to take care of the orphans. You're going to do this because by nature, human beings are selfish. You don't want to help nobody out, especially if you're hurting too. You know, I'm hungry. My kids got to eat too. I don't know what you're going to do. You can do all that. But you know what? The point is, God says, you're commanded to do this. I don't care if you are on hard times. You're going to do this. So that was the law. You got to understand, people will kind of use these kinds of principles and place it on the body of Christ today and say, you got to do this because this is what you're supposed to do. To a degree, they're right, but they're not right, because the way you view it now is different. So you can kind of give your or pay your tithes like the Levitical way, or give your tithes like Melchizedek. Next point, please. If the people didn't bring their tithes, then all of these groups will suffer. See, that's why God said it was a law, because without that particular help, there will be no temple. There will be no priest. The priest won't be able to eat. The orphans won't be taken care of because the church helped take care of the orphans. All of these different things will lack if the people didn't kind of command to bring their stuff. You understand? So a lot of things were lacking only because of people's selfishness. That's why God said it got to be a law, because all y'all not acting like Abraham. Abraham, I didn't have to tell him this, but I got to tell y'all this because y'all are too selfish. Next point. Y'all get anything? All right. After they had given their tithes, they were in a position to receive a blessing. Harvest of crops, the land, oxen, children, etc. All of these blessings would flow, but they did it because they were told to do so. And then they still qualify for a blessing. So what has changed then? Anybody? What has changed? I mean, do we give our tithes like this? We pay our tithes and, I mean, would a blessing still flow? Do we have to give tithes? You don't have to give tithes. Just like you ain't got to brush your teeth, right? But if you're smart, you want to consider this. Next point. So all my critics out there, you telling them people they got to pay tithes. You know, listen, you ain't got to pay tithes, but you will tap into a spiritual blessing if you do. I need to throw that out there because I get hate letters every now and then. So Malachi, y'all know this scripture, right? You can have like this guy, this big bag of bills right here. Or you could be kind of like this lady pulling that 100. You see the money, you're trying your best, but it's just not coming. It's just not working. Or be like our friend Donald, like, oh yeah, I found it and I'm going to keep it all to myself. Human nature is, this is what's going to happen. So here's the most famous scripture that everybody used during offering time. Malachi chapter 3, verse 8. Will a man rob or defraud God? Yet you have robbed and defrauded me. But you say, in what way do we have robbed and defrauded you? You have withheld your tithes and offerings. Verse 9, here's the thing that I'm going to zero in on. You are cursed with a curse. You are robbing me, even this whole nation. I'm going to stop right there. You are cursed with a curse. So the first curse was basically We're already under a curse when it comes to the world. Now, I say curse, I mean it in a balanced way. But no matter what you do, if you follow all the rules of the world, that's not guaranteed that you're going to make it in this world. Do everything right, have every green check. Still, there are certain things called devourers that will happen no matter what you do. I know people that, went to school and they got the right education and they got the right this and they got the right that and still can't even find a job. What happened then? I thought I was supposed to do everything right. Well, you were trusting in the world. There's a curse kind of on the world. Then there's another curse when God tells you to do something and you don't want to do it. Now you're outside the will of God. So when he says curse with a curse, he's not talking about that. He's basically saying that you're outside of everything that I have in store for you. So he says you got to kind of, in order to overlap that curse, you got to do something different from the world. Because it's not going to make sense to everybody else. Why do you give your money to God's stuff? You don't have that preacher wearing shiny suits and alligator shoes? No. You're doing that because you see what God told you to do. And this has to be a heart issue instead of something that God commanded you. You're going to bring that tithe. If you don't, I'm going to. No. That's not how you do things now. But this is how the world's going to be. You're going to, whether you do everything when it comes to the world, you're probably still going to be in debt. Me, Sally Mae, I'm praying for God. Lord, send Sally Mae away. Because Sally Mae is one of them things. It's just like it keeps growing. But anyway, we're taking care of that. So some things, no matter what you do, if you decide not to do God's principle, you can hand down some of that debt to your family, to your kids, to your generation. And God wants you to get to the point where you are overcoming these things. And you won't overcome him if you just kind of keep doing stuff what the world's do. So that's why he says, you are cursed with a curse. You're robbing me and this nation. Why did he say you're robbing me and the nation? Why didn't God just say, you're robbing me? Or, you're robbing me and these preachers? How come he didn't say that? Why did he say, you're robbing me and the nation? Anybody? That's not rhetorical.
Because what you just said about the Levites taking care of God's house, and then if they're not able to do that, then the whole community.
That word nation is actually translated community. A community of people. A group of people. So he's saying, you're robbing me, but you're also robbing the community of the potential of God's favor on this place. Lord bless us, Lord bless us. You're not in a position to be blessed because you are withholding something, just like Achan's sin. Y'all know Achan's sin? When they were going through the promised land and they destroyed Jericho and they said, okay, we're going to go to Ai. The Ai is not as big as Jericho, so we ain't going to send a whole lot of people there. So they went there and God said, don't touch anything. Don't take anything from me. But then the Bible said that Achan saw a silk robe and some gold ring or something and he took it. But the Bible says that the whole nation suffered. And then God said, Israel has sinned. He didn't say Achan has sinned. He said, all of Israel has sinned because y'all have taken something from me. And Joshua up there praying, oh, Lord, bless us. Oh, Lord, help us. And he was crying on his knees. And God said, get up. Stop praying. It's almost like God, like, I'm tired of y'all praying. Lord, bless me. Enlarge me. Bless me indeed. No, you have withheld something from me. You go get that stuff right. Then you come talk to me. That's kind of like how God saw the thing. So he doesn't see it as I'm taking my dime because I need this dime. He see it as this thing has your heart and I can't move because the money has your heart. You don't trust me in this. You're trusting more of the money in the world. So go on and carry that big bag of bills in if you want to. But if you have my help, I can make you throw away that bag of bills and have something else. But it has to be one of those things that you got to trust God in, which is in this case, he says, you are cursed with a curse. You are robbing me and this whole nation. Then he says, verse 10, bring all the tithes, the whole tenth of your income into the storehouse. The storehouse was the place where they would have the food and to protect the orphans and the community and the Levites. All of that, basically, it was the house of God where you get fed at. He said, bring that into the storehouse that there may be food or substance or results in my house. So in other words, you can be under this curse and do everything that the world do. But if you trust me in this dime of a dollar, then, verse point, go to my next point, please. Then he says, verse 11, test me in this, says the Lord. Now, this is God saying this. Not some preacher, not Creflo Dollar, not T.D. Jakes or anybody. This is what God said. He said, test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see. Everybody say see. In other words, watch it. Watch me do this. If you're going to test me with a dime out of a dollar, watch me do some of the stuff that you cannot do. and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour you out much blessing that you will not have room enough to receive it. All because of a little dime of a dollar. And some people are like, yeah, I'm gonna let a dime stop me. Well then, you have just made that other scripture about being a curse of a curse come alive in your own life. But again, God didn't say it's a law for you to do this. He said you should do this. Well, we're gonna get to that later. But because Jesus showed up, everything you do now, I'm getting ahead of myself already. So basically he says, because I know where we're going, I'm trying to just aim everything right. But he says, see why I will not throw open the windows of heaven. In other words, you have all this blessing or this, quote unquote, in our currency, money left over to go on vacation, money left over to buy that, I don't know, new purse, ladies, because again, guys don't wear purses. Shoes, okay. You got all this money left over, even though your bills are paid and everything else, and you have no stress. You're not looking to get paid on Friday, or is it payday yet? No, you got stuff left over because you trusted me with this dime of a dollar. That's what he's talking about. And he said, just test me in it then. If you don't believe me, just test me in this. Because God is true to his word, but we're not true to our word. We can say one thing and then like change our mind whenever the wind blows another way. But God, if he says something, it's gonna stay that way. All right? So he says, you are, where am I? Verse 11, I will prevent pests or devourings from devouring your crops and the vines of your field, and a field will not cast their fruit, says the Lord Almighty. Then all nations will call you blessed. Everybody gonna look at you and be like, you just look blessed to me. That's what happens. People just walk up to you and they know to approach you a different way. Not that they know you like that, but it's just like, you just look blessed to them. And God said, that's the kind of stuff that I will place on you, not the world. But notice how he says, I will prevent the devourer from devouring. There are certain things that will just happen. Even if you're doing the right things with the world, you got devouring spirits. God says, I will rebuke the devourer for your sake. If you can just trust me with this little bitty thing. It may not seem much to you, but to a lot of people, it's a lot. I don't want to give God 10%. I need to keep my 10%. God said, you can keep the 90. I just need the 10% and give it to me first. And then he said, by doing that, I'll rebuke the devourer for your sake. Your crops will keep on growing. You won't have pests. You won't have all this extra work going all over again and starting all over from scratch again. I tell you all the time, I'm tired of starting over. I want to, if God tells me to do something, I want it to continue, but I don't want to keep starting over. Verse 12, then all nations will call you blessed, for yours will be a delight in the land, be a delightful land, says the Lord Almighty. People will see that the blessing is just on you. They know that they can come to you for help and everything. In other words, you'll be blessed so that you can be a blessing to other people. But you got to be able to trust God with this kind of thing first. So give them the dime. Now, last point, and we're almost done. I'm going to show you what Jesus said. Go ahead. So Jesus' view on this. He said, woe to you Pharisees, you religious people, you hypocrites, you Pharisees, and you know, so forth. For you tithe mint and rue and every little herb, but disregard and neglect justice and the love of God. Notice what he says. These you ought to do, talking about the tithe and everything. You ought to do, but don't leave the others undone. In other words, Jesus is saying like this. If you're smart, you'll do this. You don't have to do it because it's the law. No, we're not under the law. He says, but if you're going to tithe, you should do that, but don't leave the others undone. Don't be tithing and still be mean. If you're going to be a child of God, be a child of God and do it with some of the stuff that, you know, the Old Testament was talking about. But now you do it in a different kind of perspective. Next point. I'm just flowing through it a lot because I got two more scripts after this. Here's the key why I say everything that I've been saying so far. Matthew chapter 5, verse 17 and 18. Don't misunderstand why I have come. This is Jesus speaking. Don't misunderstand why I have come. I did not come to abolish the law. In other words, I didn't come to throw all of this stuff out. Old Testament stuff that you see in the Bible, I didn't come to just say, y'all ain't got to do that no more. I didn't come for that. What do you say? I came, blah, Moses, or it's writing. No, I came to accomplish or fulfill or update the law. So everything you see in the Bible, yeah, that's from God. But I didn't come to throw it out. I came to make it be fulfilled. I came to make it applicable to you so that you can use this. Now, this is how he says it. Verse 18. I tell you the truth, until heaven and earth disappear, not even the smallest detail of God's law will disappear until its purpose is achieved. So if it's in the Bible, God says, I'm still behind it. Jesus says, I'm Jesus Christ, and I approve this message. That's basically what he said. But he's saying that I approved it, but I came to fulfill it, to make sure that you are operating at it 100%. Next point. So Jesus would never tear down or disregard the written law. Everything you see in the word, he's behind it then, okay? Keep going. Teacher, what is the most important commandment of the law? Jesus said, you must love. Everybody say love.
Love.
You must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind. Verse 38, this is the first and greatest commandment. In other words, you had all these other commandments that God has given them, 10 commandments. It ended up being almost 3,000 commandments. But by the time Jesus came, he says it's going to be summed up in two things. Love God, and then verse 39. And the second is equally important. Love your neighbor as yourself. Basically this. All those laws that they were talking about, yeah, that's good. I didn't want to throw it away. But it's all summed up in one thing. You love God, you love people. If you love God and you love people, you are fulfilling all of those laws that were that's right here. So everything you do from now on ought to have a foundation of love in it. Not of law, but love. So in other words, God, I know your word says this, but if you don't love God, you're not going to do the commandments, no matter what. Okay? So he says, verse 40, the entire law, love your neighbors as yourself, verse 40, the entire law and all of the demands of this prophet are based on these two commandments. So anything you do from now on, it got to have love with it. Well, I'll pay my tithes, but I don't want to. I don't love to pay my tithes. Don't do it then. Then just keep your little dime, because it's not going to work, because God wants you to do it out of love for God, love people. I don't want to see the kingdom blessed. Okay, then keep it then. But don't try to jump on other people and say, y'all shouldn't be tithing just because you don't love God. Excuse me. Sorry. Just because you don't love the things of God or whatever. You just make sure God touches your heart then. You got to mature. Next point, please. Out of all of the commandments God gave Moses and all the prophecy given, Jesus condensed them into two commandments so that the average person can fulfill all of them every day. See, we don't know all the other laws that was back in the Bible. You don't have a list of what things you're supposed to be doing, but you will fulfill it if you just love God. Okay? If you love God, you'll fulfill all those other commandments because you're doing it with the right reason. Last point, and then we're done. Let's go. All right. And a new commandment I give you, love one another as I have loved you. So you must love one another. By this, all men will know that you are my disciples, even if you love one another. Jesus basically talking about it has to be, it always got to come from love. It always got to come from something that's out of your heart before it comes from following these laws, following what's going on. Next one. Again, I know it's a lot of scriptures. Famous scripture again, John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave. Again, it talks about God loves that he gave. He did this that he gave. God didn't love and said, I have to do this. He did it because he loved, and that's why he gave. That whoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life. Next point. The motive behind everything you do should be based in love and not out of a commandment. Just how a child matures into an adult. When you're a child, you thought as a child. You did things because people told you that's the right thing to do. But when you grow up, you got to just do it because you're a mature Christian. Okay? So to answer the question, do you have to tithe? No, you don't have to tithe. But if you're a mature person and you want to still tap into those blessings that God is talking about, rebuking the devourer and all this kind of stuff, if you're smart, give God a dime out of every dollar and honor him with that first. And then he said, test me and watch and see if I will do this kind of stuff. So it all goes back on the individual instead of just the church body. Because if it doesn't hit your heart, it's not going to do anything. So I tithe because I love God. I tithe because I learned, you know, these principles. I don't tithe just so I can get something back. As a result of me tithing, I don't have a lot of devouring spirits on me. As a result of me tithing, I have a lot of things that's going for me that the average person probably can't get involved with because I tapped into a kingdom principle. But it's not so I can look all big and bad and special. But it's because I do this because my foundation of it is out of love and not out of the law. Now that's the last point. All right, you bring a dime out of a dollar because you love God and you show him your love through your giving. So you give because you love God. Again, we always talk about that in offering. You tithe because that's what God placed on your heart to do. And you tithe just like Abraham. You respect him, you honor him. if we're ever going to be one of those churches that are going to have an impact in the city, we won't be able to just walk into that blessing. We got to be tithers. But it got to be something that God has to touch every single one of you all's heart on. Because at the end of the day, I'm going to tithe, and I say this humbly, but I'm going to be blessed because I tithe. But, you know, when it comes to you all, you got to make a decision, every single one of you. My boys was talking to me last night, said, I want to start tithing. So they brought their money and they want to start tithing. But I didn't make them do it. I didn't choke them out and say, you're going to tithe, boy. Tithe. I ain't going to do that. I taught them the same way I'm teaching you all, and they just said, you know what? I want to start tithing. So it's going to be tough sometimes. Some people, you know, you're going to have either be tithe or they're going to have to pay the rent. I mean, you got to take that up with God. With me, I've been to those places where it's like this money was this going here, and I had to decide, who am I going to trust God with? I'm going to trust the world or trust God? Okay? That's what you got to do. And if you do that, the blessings will flow. Last point. So a dime out of every dollar. Make that decimal 1 point to the left. God just wants to see, can he trust you with the tithes? And it will stop the devouring. I'm a living witness. It will stop the devouring if you tap into this principle. Now, you have to go home and talk to God, because sometimes God may draw the nail in by what I'm saying right now and say, it's time for you to tithe. Or he wants you to faithfully tithe or whatever. But you got to make sure you do what God calls you to do if you're going to operate in that blessing. Any questions? Comments? Y'all not ready to? Okay. Oh, okay. No, that was more of a sacrificial offering. Yeah. And that part is good, but that still came out of their heart too. You know, the reason why God didn't accept Cain's offering is because his heart wasn't in it. He kind of just gave him fruit of the land, but it was probably rotten fruit and everything that he didn't want. And God said he despised that offering, but he loved Abel's offering because Abel gave him the best of his sheep. So it all depends. God always looks at your heart. Okay? Anything else? Y'all okay? Y'all not going to stone me? Yes, sir.
I love it.
You love it?
Yes.
Okay.
I didn't know the thing about what you
said. Melchizedek?
Yeah.
What was it?
Theophany.
Oh, you wait till we get the bronze. Y'all gonna learn about all that stuff. Woo, watch out. But a theophany is something when we're gonna learn more about the Trinity. But I had to give you all this teaching. And don't worry, I'm not gonna keep on talking about. I know some people they talk about tithing every Sunday. I'm not one of those guys. But I have an obligation as a pastor to show you all this. I gotta show you it, and then let the Holy Spirit jump on you. Because once you leave this place. Oh yeah, Holy Spirit will knock on you. Now you know what you need to do now. That's what he'll do. My job is just to give you the word. And your job is to walk it out. Walk it out. Yes, ma'am.
How did he even know the 10%? I kept missing that part.
He was a friend of God. He think like so how he God, knew. He just knew. And then God says, you know what, for the rest of you all this. See, Abraham had a relationship with God like nobody else had. I think Moses was probably like the closest one. But Abraham, the Bible said that God talked to him, just like I talked to Moses face to face. And Abraham just kind of just did it out of his heart. And I think from that point on, God like, ooh, Abraham, you touched my heart. I want the rest of you all to do that. It probably set off a new type of dimension of faith. But whatever he did, God said, from now on, I'm a place in the law. And then when Jesus came, he says, it's not a law anymore. I want you to do it just because like how Abraham did it. So that's where we are at the body of Christ in current day. We do it because how Abraham did, not because it's a law. Okay? So don't y'all let people put that pressure on you like, you gonna give, you gonna be cursed. Don't let them do that, because you do it out of the right way. And then if you do it the right way, God will bless you. Okay? Anything else?
So about
the,
you said something about
like
declaration.
Yes. I believe we, and y'all help me out on this, but I've always personally, before I would give my tithes and offering, I would kind of speak over it to myself and just kind of say, Lord, you know, yes, I probably need this money for the car note or whatever. I'm trusting you with this. Bless my home. Bless my children. Bless my wife. But, you know, I would do that before I give it, you know, because it was something out of my heart. Because sometimes out of the heart, the mouth speaks. So whatever's in you, you kind of need to let it come out, and it will kind of actually go in a direction of where you're speaking. And so when you give that the right way, with the right heart and everything, no matter if somebody else next to you is giving for the wrong reasons, you gave for the right reasons. And then that's how God will start to make it rain on you. And then he'll stop up everything else on everybody else. But because you did it the right way. So we maybe need to do some kind of offering confession before, after things, just so all of us corporately, so we can kind of know. Yes, ma'am.
I like that because it helps you remember to keep your heart into it. That
yes.
It's not just rote, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And times that I've, like when you talked about the, he brought the bread and the wine,
mm-hmm.
you know, it's like you get that idea of communion.
Mm-hmm.
It means something.
It does.
And so I think, you know, for me too, when I, you know, speak over what I'm giving, I mean, I've just got some caught up.
Yeah.
just talking about, you know, the idea of what God has done and,
mm-hmm.
you know, with the battle, you know, God, he only had 300 something people and there mm-hmm. were five kings. And
yeah.
They won.
Mm-hmm.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
And it's like just being thankful and just, you know, you're able to put your heart into it,
yeah.
which is what God is.
That's what we're looking for. That's all he's looking for. Mm-hmm.
That, you know, that declaring just really, for me, it just really makes it real.
It does.
You put your heart into it, and then also it kind of commemorates it.
Yes.
Because then,
yeah.
you know, when you see a harvest and you see God even continue to bless
you, you can connect the dots.
Wow.
Yeah,
you know,
that's it. That's right. Y'all got some questions there? Yes. I'm going to get you next.
Uh-huh. For me, that mm-hmm. helps.
Yeah.
When I come into a church and I see that,
mm-hmm.
I don't really know
why doing it. Yeah.
But you know, it's kind of like that. It's like kind of in service. And
yeah. Well, we need to make an offering confession that's full of the word that we all kind of say corporately, and we'll probably have that by next week or so.
Because it's also faith. Because mm-hmm. we talk about you're not paying tithes,
giving. Mm-hmm.
And so he talks about, you know, when you give, you know, good measure pressed down, shaken together, you know.
Mm-hmm.
It's not that we're giving to get, but it's just also remembering, hey, wait a minute, this is actually a seed.
Yeah.
Who knows how in my heart this
yeah.
is a seed.
Yeah.
So I can still have faith.
Faith in that.
There, you know?
Because God's word is not mocked, and he says Jesus is the incorruptible seed. And so sometimes I don't want you all to see it as I'm just planting, and that's good. It is true, but it's because you've given it with the right harvest, by default, you're going to get something back. It's not that you're looking for that, but it's just the natural way of doing things. Yes, ma'am.
That's how we used to do it too. Our old pastor
mm-hmm.
used to say heaven is what's activated. So we did a lot of that, like
yeah. Exactly.
Kind of stuff, you know?
Once you say something, it kind of makes it come alive and it solidifies it that this is actually something. So it's not just you just dropping money in a bucket or whatever. And when you're giving tithes, it works. It's a spirit because I've been doing it for years and I'm telling you, it works. So I had to bring this out to you all. Okay.
Yeah.
Amen. Anything else?
I love it.
You love it. Good. Good. This church is a blessed church, I believe.
Thank you for listening to Upon the Rock broadcast. If this message has been a blessing, you can help us spread the gospel by sharing this message with your friends. Also, if you're online, please be sure to contact me, either through our website at shakirministries.org or through social media. I would love to hear from you. Together, we can build a godly foundation in the lives of people. Until next time, please know that I'm praying for you, and I hope to see you on our next broadcast.